Imagine being Adam and Eve for a second. You're in the garden and it's perfect. It is literally heaven on earth. You are with God. You're with the animals. You're able to name the animals. You have little fountains growing out of the ground. Everyone's living in harmony. And because of your decisions, God's taking one of his creations right in front of you and he's killing it. What do you think Adam and Eve felt at that moment when they had to see God skinning an animal in front of them to clothe their shame and their sin? And now this first offering, this first sacrifice right here is a huge foreshadowing of what Christ came to do for us by his sacrifice with his body on a cross, with his blood to cover our shame, our guilt, our sin. We're starting a new series today called The Afterlife. I'm very, very passionate about this topic. When God got a hold of my life when I was 21 years old in an apartment dorm room on a Christian campus, I was far from God, but God was not far from me. And he found me in my darkest moment. He reached out and he called me to him and I responded. And once I did that, I was radically changed. There was no turning back. I gave up drugs. I gave up drinking. I gave up the world. And I just said, I want to pursue this one that has loved me unconditionally and found me in my darkest moment. And I know the same God that I have given my life to, that I've put my faith and trust in, is the same God that's here today and can do the same thing for you. And when I was moving forward, I started asking questions about the afterlife. If there's a God who created him. When we die, what happens when we die? How can I know for sure that there is a heaven, there is a hell? Do we all go to heaven like dogs? Is there a hell? Like, can you get out of hell? Can someone pray you out of it? What are all these things, right? There's all these different thoughts that go into it. There's all different types of religions. And if there is God who loves me so much, we could find me in a moment like that, I want to make it my faith and my journey. And I don't know about any of you, if you're on that path right now and you're like, I'm just trying to make this my faith. I want to have this be my decision, not my parents or a pastor's, my grandparents, my aunts, my uncles, my cousins. I want to pursue Christ. And this is a big series that we're going to be doing. It's going to answer a lot of questions. There's going to be hot topics in this. But with that, I kind of have a fire under my butt this morning. Last night I went to the Lord in prayer. On Saturdays, I usually try to get isolated and just go spend time with the Lord. I try to be quiet and just hear and listen to him. And man, he was wrecking me in a lot of ways. If you're joining us for our fast, I've been fasting and just seeking the Lord. And last night he just was unpacking things in my life I didn't know was there. When I was going to him, I saw I was arrogant, proud in situations, and that hurts. It hurts when God reveals things. Jealousy, bitterness, there was a lot that he was just taking out, and I was like, oh my goodness. But that is the point to our walk, is for you and me to fully die to ourselves so that Christ can live in you. For him to fully work in your life, there could be none of you left. And I'll tell you, this walk as a Christian has been very humbling, because even when you think, wow, I got my act together, God's like, whoosh, here's some spots, man. I'm gonna hit this right now. I'm gonna let you know about this. And man, it was humbling. And then I started thinking of just what is the point to all this. And we have a lot going on in our world right now, right? We have political things going on right now, the voting that's happening. And as Christians, yes, absolutely, we need to vote. If we want to continue our freedom and gathering and continue our freedom and going to a church where we can lift our hands up and we can praise God, we got to get off our butts and go vote. We have to. And the thing is I don't, as Christians, just want to fixate on that, though, and make that be the point to all this. And why aren't you talking about politics? Why are you talking about, like, man, there's more to life than that. There are deaths happening right now. On the East Coast in 6 different states, there's over 220 deaths that have happened from this hurricane. And there's times that we're going to talk about real things, because at the end of the day, all of us are going to take our last breath, and for the first time in our lives, our hands are going to go like this. We constantly are like this with our hands, right? Grabbing for things. When you're born, you grab the finger of the doctor or your parent, and then you grab a little tricycle, then you grab a pencil because you're going to school, and then you grab your books for college, and you grab the hand of a boyfriend or girlfriend, and then you grab a ring because you're going to propose, and then you're holding his or her hand at the altar, and then you're holding your child's hand, and then, well, there's going to be a day where you take your last breath, and for the first time in your life and in my life, our hands are going to go like this. And the question that we're going to be asking through this series is, whose hands are you in? Whose hands are you in when yours go like this? And as a church, if you're able, if you're willing, I want to get on our knees as a church, because this is the way that we should be. The church will grow in this way as if we pray. And I'm going to get on my knees. I do this as a posture of my heart to the Lord, saying, Lord, I just want to come to you. I'm not worthy, but because of Christ we did on the cross, I'm able to come to you. I don't need anyone to be a mediator to come to me and you, but I'm going to get on my knees. I'm going to pray. I want to pray for all those in the hurricane right now, that we can find safety, peace, that loved ones are going to be okay. But one thing I want to say is this to the churches that are out in those six states. Thank you for getting off your butts and being the church and going and donating things to people and just being the hands and feet of Christ. When's the last time you've seen the church coming together and being powerful? I'm seeing it right now in those six states, and I'm sure that there's more, but thank you, church. And this, I want you guys to see right now where we're at in our world. It's not like, hey, let's talk about the future. It's time to talk about things now. Let's get our act together. Let's not just glue in here on Sundays and Wednesdays, but let's do this every single day and see the needs, be the hands and feet of Christ, and turn this world upside down for once. Can we do that? And so let's start right now by praying. If you can join me, if you're able to, if you're willing, I'm just going to get on my knees. If you guys can join me, I want to pray for all those right now that are just on the East Coast, that just tragedy is happening and there's big things happening. People's lives are changed. And so, Lord, we are coming to you right now. As a church, we're coming to you with our hearts saddened. I can't comprehend what families are going through right now. I can't comprehend what that would be like to see your loved one get swept away. Your house is destroyed. All your memories are in those houses, Lord. Please, Lord, bring comfort to the families that have been impacted by this. Bring discernment to those that are searching and trying to help, and strength to those that are weak right now. Lord, I ask that through all this, that your name is glorified somehow, that your name gets lifted up, that people are able to see you in these darkest moments, that they're able to see your hand in tragedies. May there be one person, Lord, somewhere out there that is just going to give you the glory and the credit and the praise in a moment like this. And may there be revival in our nation. Help us not to just get distracted by things that are going on, but to get focused on what you've called us to do, making disciples and advancing your kingdom. And I know it takes moments like these, Lord, that we can really express Jesus Christ by going out and serving. That is exactly what you came to do for us. Lord, collect those tears that are happening right now and write them in your book. May you bring salvation through this flood. Continue to protect homes that another hurricane's coming. Lord, I ask for your supernatural hand of protection over houses that are going to be in Florida or North or South Carolina, Lord, and the other states that there are. I just pray for supernatural protection. And Lord, keep purifying me in this church, so that we don't hinder your spirit, but that it could go out and do what it needs to do, so we can continue to witness in times like this. We love you, Lord. We praise you. We ask all these things in the name above all names, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you, church. Thank you. If you have a Bible, you can open up and join with me and turn to the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 9. If you need a Bible, raise your hand, and some of our ushers will be coming down and handing you a Bible. So if you need a Bible, raise your hand. If you have a Bible, go ahead and open up and turn to Hebrews chapter 9. We're going to look in verse 27. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Do any of you remember, let's see, Y2K? Remember Y2K, right?
The world was ending. The world was going to end. That was it. Christ was coming back. And I know us today, with looking at the world right now, we can laugh at ourselves and you know, during Y2K, but the world was going to end. I remember my family and I, we gathered up all the water bottles. Sound familiar? all the waters, and we got like all the canned foods, and we stored up my mom's like minivan, the ones that looked like rocket ships. I don't know if you guys remember those in the 90s. And we drove to my grandma's house. To grandmother's house we go, and it was up in the mountains far away. And we're like, well, we'll just die as a family, I guess. So we went there to my grandma's house, and it was in Auburn, California, very beautiful place. And I remember us all huddled around the TV, just like you do on New Year's Eve, right? You're all huddled around the TV. Now, I don't know when the last time was I made it to midnight, but back then, you know, staying up past midnight was the dream. And in New York, you see the ball on top of the tower, and you know the famous thing that happens. What happens? The countdown begins, right? The countdown begins, and you hear the 10, 9. And for some reason, we're all excited, but the world's going to end, right? We're all excited, yeah, woo! And it gets down to 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and it drops, and you're celebrating, and nothing happened. Except it was a new year, woo! You know? You guys remember that? And that right there, that just a little visual of the countdown is exactly what happens in our lives when it comes to life and death. Right now, there is a countdown to your life and to mine. Let that hit you for a second. You can't escape it. At some point in our lives, unless Christ returns for the church, we are going to pass away. And this is what we're going to talk about today in today's message is, why is there death? Why is there death? And we're going to go deeper than just sin. That's a huge part of it. We're going to go deeper than that today. But this is the first message in this four-week series that we're doing is, why is there death? And if you look in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, in this one verse right here, we're going to unpack a lot of this, and we're going to go through our Bibles a lot. We love the Word of God. We want to know it. We want to grow in it, and we want to go and share it. So this is what it says in Hebrews 9:27. It says, "And just as it is appointed for people to die once, and after this judgment." You guys see this right here? And just as it is what? Appointed. You and I have an appointment. It's booked. God's not going to revoke that. Me and you have an appointment for death. Matt, this isn't encouraging me. But I'm here to, I love you all. I love people. I want to go share Christ with people. And this is a reality that we need to get our heads around, is this is an appointment that we have that we cannot erase it and reschedule. We have an appointment. It's for death. And then after this judgment, we're going to talk about that judgment in just a little bit right now. But this is for all of us, for people to die. We're going to die once. And after this judgment. Now, for the believer, I won't get to unpack this part, is for the believer, this death is our physical bodies. Our spiritual bodies will not die. After this is judgment. And we'll unpack this some more, but I want you to write these two things down. There's two different judgments. There's one, there's called the Great White Throne Judgment. The Great White Throne Judgment is where unbelievers go to be judged. And then there's the judgment seat of Christ. This is where believers will go. And we'll unpack some more of those, but there's two judgments that happen. But just as every people are supposed to die once and after this judgment. So now let's go to Romans 6:23. This is something that we can't escape. This is something that we're going to face, but how are we going to face it? Are we going to face it well, or are we going to be fearful? Romans 6:23, this whole book of Romans is great for understanding salvation, understanding what happens, understanding that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, understanding that that we are forgiven. There's so much meat in this book of Romans. Romans 6, you guys probably know this one, 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is salvation in Jesus Christ, our Savior. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Right here, this, the wages of sin. Why is there death? Because that is what we have earned. This is your payment. A lot of us know what wages are. There was the strikes that happened on the docks. There's a bunch of minimum wages that are going on. There's a bunch of changes. We know what wages is. This is what you earn in your life for your work. Do you want to know, human beings, what we have earned for our work? Death. This is what is given. This is our payment for who we are, and what we're doing here is death. This is how good we are. I'm not here to tell you that, hey, if you do good enough, you can escape this wage. No, the payment for mine and your physical body because of sin in this world is death. This is what you and I deserve on this life. No matter how hard you work, no matter how much you try to be good, no matter how much you try to pray, no matter how much you try to read your Bible, you cannot escape this. This is the payment that you are getting, is death. Now that's sad, isn't it? It should break your heart. In fact, if you've ever had a loved one or someone close to you pass away, doesn't it feel like this isn't right? I know I'm not alone in that. It makes you feel like, wait, this does not make sense. I want to tell you that that is God's thumbprint on your heart to go back to him and say, I know. Why? Because in the very beginning when he created everything, we were not created to die. Everything points back to God. And the fact that we feel this isn't right, you're right. In the original design, we were not meant to die, but sin is what brought that. That's what drove that. And so when that doesn't feel right, it's just to turn our attention to God and say, Lord, I am sorry for our sins because this is a consequence. You see Jesus cry, one of the longest verses in the Bible, just kidding. He says, Jesus wept. I believe that there's a lot of reasons in that little small verse right there. Jesus wept. I think he even cries because this is a result of sin and it breaks his heart. It breaks his heart to see his children suffering for consequences that when he designed it perfect, we chose to go away, and this is a consequence. Have you ever had to give your children consequences? It breaks your heart sometimes, doesn't it? And why do we do it? We don't do it because we don't love them. We do it because we do love them, and we don't want them to keep on this behavior because we know we've lived it, we've done it, we know where this behavior goes. And unfortunately, because of sin, the punishment that we have is death. But you know what I love? Can you pull that verse back up there? You know what I love? Is the buts. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. I love that we can always find the answer in Jesus. I love that I cannot find the answers in this world. I've tried. If I look for the answers in this world, it's going to bring me to what? To death. But if I look at the gift that God's given me of his son, Jesus Christ, I can experience what? Eternal life. It's a free gift. I did nothing to deserve it, nothing to earn it. Why? Because my payment is death. But here's what God says, is he's like, I love you so much that I'm sending my son to die for you so that you don't have to taste death once and for all spiritually. When you put your faith, your trust, your repentance from this world and come to me, you can experience eternal life. I don't know about you, but that sounds good to me. Knowing that I can live forever? People are trying to figure that stuff out now. And I'm like, why would I want to live forever in this world? There's got to be something better than this. There is. It's paradise. It's heaven with God. Praising him, just like we did for all eternity. Praising the creator that created us. And so the wages of sin is death. Now, you may say, that doesn't seem fair. Why do we have to suffer for someone else that went against God years ago? Why do we got to go through that? Now, it's football season. I see football jerseys in here. We're trying to pray for some of those with certain jerseys on in here. We're trying to get that repentance. Football season. All you got to do is go watch a football game. Any offensive linemen in here? Anyone ever do the offensive line? Like, finally, I get acknowledged. Anyone? No. Okay, so I'm ashamed. I can't do it. How about defensive line? Anyone on the defensive line in here? Anyone did that? Pastor John? Okay. When you mess up for going offsides, who gets penalized? The team. For one person's mess up, there's a flag. And when the flag gets thrown, the whole team suffers for one person's mistake. For some reason, we can comprehend that on earth, can't we? but we question God when it happens to us. We can comprehend it by a silly game, but when it comes to God's judgment, when it comes to God's goodness, we'll question him for consequences. Why would a bad thing happen to someone good like me? And you just saw our goodness leads to what? Death. The whole team suffers for one person's mistakes. I want to go all the way back to, and you guys are like, man, I thought we escaped Genesis. Let's go to Genesis chapter 2, shall we? Go to Genesis chapter 2. We're going all the way to the beginning to understand this concept of it's more than just a physical death. There's a physical death that's going to happen as a consequence for sin. But now let's go into the whole design and what has happened. Why did this trickle all the way down to us? Genesis chapter 2, and we're going to look at verse 15. And before we get into this right here, you guys remember the first 10 words in the Bible? In the beginning, God created the what? The heavens and the earth. You have time, space, matter all right there, by the way. Time, space, matter. In the beginning, there's your time. God created the heavens. There's your space and the earth. Your matter shows, just to answer this question, shows God's outside of time. He's outside of all those things, so no one had to create him. He created everything. Time, space, matter. For anything to come into existence, those three things have to take place. So he's outside of those things. He creates all those things. And what I love, it says, he said, let there be light. And then he says, let there be land. Let there be stars. And it was so, and it was good. And let there be animals. And you know what I love? When it came to mankind, he created us in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Do you see God's original design? If he wanted it any other way, he would have done so. But he created man and woman to be together at the very beginning. And through this design, he said this. He says, at the end of all this, he says, it was very good. No sin yet. In fact, God was able to rest. He created man and woman to be together. And I think this is so important to know, young people, listen to me right now. We did not come from a Big Bang. We did not develop from monkeys. We have an intelligent designer. One single cell of our body is more complex than the cell phone. And we have a creator who purposely and handmade you and I. We are not a mistake. There is nothing wrong with you. He has designed you and created you out of love, for love. What the world's trying to tell our young generation is you were created by nothing for nothing. Now go figure it out. Go mutilate yourselves. Hear me. We were created by God Almighty to live out his love. Because when you and I understand that he loves us so much that he created us, my wife and I wanted kids so bad. Do I know there's a risk that they may walk away from me? Yes. Do I know there's a risk that they may never say, I love you, Dad? Yes. Did it stop me from wanting to have kids? Absolutely not. Why? I want people to love and to spoil. God did the same thing for me and you. He loves you so much that he created you. Not only that, he spoke everything else. And what did he do with Adam? Made him in his hand. You and I have been in his hands from the very beginning. And I don't know about you, but I can't wait to be in those hands again. You weren't something that he wanted to just skim by and say, let there be humans. That is how much he's thought of you. The intention behind you. The masterpiece that you are. He held you in his hands and he's forming you. He knows every hair on your head. He knows the things that you're going to go through. And he just wants you to be in his hands. And what makes you and I different than all other creation is the breath of life that he breathed into Adam's nostrils. Now hear me on this. This is why this is important. You can't miss this. Our bodies are physical, created from dust. And when we die from dust, we're going to return. But now what is there? The breath of life that's in you. This is your soul. This is your spirit right here. This is what God has breathed into you. And this is the part that you don't want to die. We are going to die. Our physical bodies, because of sin, they're decaying. I'm going gray. And we're going to go right back to where we started, back to dust. But now listen to this. There's something that's in you that we should take and love and just think, thank you, God, as he breathed his breath into you and to me. And you are life. And that life starts at the beginning. I want to even I want to even give to you that this. I think that the point of life starts way even before conception because God already thought of you. And if God breathes life into something, don't you want to uphold that and to love that and to respect it? And that's what makes a difference between you and I. And then he put man in the garden. He says this in verse 15. The Lord took man and placed him in the Garden of Eden to work it and watch over it. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree of the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For on the day you eat it, you will certainly die. He created man in his image. He created woman from the side of man. And they come together, and now man's going to work. And what does God tell him? You can have it all. We're walking in fellowship with one another. We're worshiping together through even service. And we just get time together. You guys, we can talk together. Wow. And he gives him one thing, just one thing. You can have it all, but what? But don't eat from one tree. And I want to tell you right now, that is exactly how the devil's going to work. He's going to try to get you to think God's holding something from you. And he doesn't want you to experience what good really is. But isn't that interesting? Adam and Eve had it all. They can eat from any tree. And God says, just don't eat from one, because you'll on that day, you'll surely die. This word, certainly die or surely, it just means over time. So it doesn't mean instant for anyone. It's like, why didn't they die right when they eat it? It means over time, you will die. And he tells them because he loves them. They're innocent. And then what happens in Genesis chapter 3? This one's known as the fall, this chapter. Genesis chapter 3, 19. They eat, and now consequence happens. And here you go in 19. You will eat bread by the sweat of your brow until you return to the ground, since you were taken from it. For you are dust, and you will return to dust. Just let that hit you for a second. We're created from dust, and now we're going to return to dust. Why? Because we disobeyed God. We turned away. This isn't God's doing. This was ours. It's our sin. This is a curse on the world. The part of the curse is death. Now there's death that's in the world. And he's saying, from this dust you were created, and now from it you're going to return. The man named his wife Eve because she's the mother of all the living. The Lord God made clothing from skins for the man and his wife, and he clothed them. I want you to hear how heartbreaking this is. Adam and Eve had not experienced death before. Now God's telling them as a consequence, there's going to be death. Now you're going to return to this. And then you see right here, the first death recorded in the Bible. Imagine being Adam and Eve for a second. You're in the garden, and it's perfect. It is literally heaven on earth. You are with God. You're with the animals. You're able to name the animals. You have little fountains growing out of the ground. Everyone's living in harmony. And because of your decisions, God's taking one of his creations right in front of you and he's killing it. What do you think Adam and Eve felt at that moment when they had to see God skinning an animal in front of them to clothe their shame and their sin? And the amazing thing about this is he was still providing for them because they tried to cover themselves up and that wasn't even good enough. God says, I will cover you up because only God is good. What he can do for us is good. And he had to, in front of them, kill an animal and skin it to cover their shame. And now this first offering, this first sacrifice right here is a huge foreshadowing of what Christ came to do for us by his sacrifice with his body on a cross, with his blood to cover our shame, our guilt, our sin. But here you have the first death recorded. Now imagine being Adam and Eve. Wouldn't that shock you? Wouldn't that be sad? Would your heart not be broken? The animal that just came to you that you just named is now the one that is skinning, being skinned in front of you so you could be covered for your mistakes, your decisions. Do you think this breaks God's heart? Absolutely. It should break our hearts that this is a result of sin and our choices that we have made. But you know what I love? Is God is so good in his promises, and in this curse, he actually has the first solution of Jesus Christ. And he talks to the serpent. He says, hey, from this, hey, someone's going to come. He's going to crush your head, and you will bruise his heel. And God kicks them out of the garden. This is what I love. Why didn't God kill them right then and there? Well, that is part of the consequence. We're going to die. But he kicks them out of the garden instead so that they can't eat from the tree of life. Because if they eat from that tree, guess where they will be for all eternity? Eating life, living forever with sin. He pushes them out so that there's a solution to their sin. But with this wedge, now there's separation from God. When there is spiritual separation, so now there's sin in the body, human flesh separation, which is now death. We're going to that. But now, this is the spiritual death. There was a wedge right now between us and God, and we are separated from his presence because of sin. We are separated from his presence because of sin. This is going to be a spiritual death. If you do not put your faith, your trust in Jesus Christ, if you do not repent from your sins and turn to him, you will be forever separated from God in hell. Hell is a real place, and it's a final place. No one can pray you out of it. No one can baptize you out of it. It is final. You are living your second chance right now. And this is a wedge right here because of sin. Now there's a spiritual death where we cannot be in God's presence because of sin. We had to be driven out. Imagine that you have a fan or an appliance at your home and it's plugged into its source of power. Adam and Eve were able to walk and talk with God. They were able to do everything and they were connected to their power source. When they sinned, they're now disconnected from their power source. And what happens over time? That fan stops spinning and it dies. That's us. We have now been disconnected from our power source because of sin. And not only physically are we going to die, there is an afterlife. And now spiritually, there is a death, separation from God. I want you to think of every good thing on this planet. And for us in Arizona, one of the favorite good things that we have is this invention called AC. Amen. Imagine that. That is good. I don't think anyone would disagree with that. That's good. Man, I love that. The light, I could see. We have lights on in our church, by the way, so you could read your Bibles with us. Light is good. Now imagine a place of no light, no AC, separated from everything that's good, which is God, for all eternity. You can't escape it. Have you ever been in a room that's pitch black? For 5 minutes, that could drive you crazy. Imagine that for eternity. No escaping, just that. Not only that, you're not able to be in God's presence, and without his presence, there's no hope in your life, which is why we live in a hopeless world, because we're looking for God. Now, if you can with me, let's go all the way back to Romans 5, verse 2, or verse 12. Romans 5, verse 12, and this again is going to explain all these consequences that have happened from one man's actions. We're all have consequences for this. Romans 5, verse 12. So again, Adam and Eve sinned. They did exactly what God said not to do. And now that's been passed down to us. And now our bodies are decaying. They're dying. But there's a spiritual separation as well. And Romans 5, verse 12 says the same thing. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, in this way, death spread to all people because all what? Sinned. You and I have sinned. We've missed the mark. It's an archery term. If you've ever seen a bullseye, that bullseye is the goal. It's perfection. If you shoot the arrow and it misses the bullseye, that's an archery term called sin. You've missed the mark of perfection. You and I have missed that mark. We mess up every single day. I mess up every single day. I shared with you last night in my room praying. God was revealing all these things that have been in here because of my sin. I can't help it. I have this sin DNA in here. Now, this is bad news, isn't it? That there is death. This is sad. It's sad that not only is there death, but now we're separated from God and you and I cannot get back to him on our own. You saw what the wages are. Our wages for our actions and who we are is death. But this is what I love about God. He never leaves us there. In your darkest moments, God does not leave you there. When you mess up, God does not leave you there. When you have turned back to things, God does not leave you there. He has created you from love, for love, and we're to express this love to other people. But he will come, he will find you in that darkness and call you back to himself. He's the God of second chances right now. He doesn't leave you where you're at. He doesn't leave you hopeless. And so now let's look at this in Hebrews 2, verse 9. You guys are like, wow, this is a Bible workout. Absolutely. I love reading the Bible and studying and finding all these connections and letting this transform my life. Not what man says, but what the Holy Spirit says through his pen that he used through man on these pages. This is how much God loves his creation, is he didn't leave us in our sin in that separation for all time with that wedge that's between him and us, is he has a solution. You see, hell is a design for the devil and his demons to put them away for all time. But because of our consequences, that wedge that is between us and our source of power, now there's separation from God for all eternity, that is where we will go. I want you to think of even how scary that statement is. What was it originally designed for? The devil and his demons. And apart from God, that's what we're like. I don't care how good you think you are. That is what we have gotten from God for our decisions. Eternal separation in a place that is designed for the devil and his demons. But now, the good news. This is the gospel. Gospel means good news. Jesus loves you so much that he came down. He left everything to come down on a rescue love mission to reunite God with his creation. Can I just say amen to that? Without this, there is no hope in our world. In Hebrews 2, verse 9, it says this, "But we do see Jesus made lower than the angels for a short time so that by God's grace, he might taste death for everyone, crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death." Christ came down. This is the King of all kings, who all praise goes to, who loves you and I so much. He even gave up some of his divine powers to come down in human form, 100% human, 100% God. The human part of him did not sin, and it tasted death for all of us once and for all. There had to be a sacrifice for our sins. Let me tell you this, is for us to ever experience life, there has to be a death. This is how God works. For there to be any type of rebirth, there has to be a death. What they did before Christ, they would have to kill animals and sacrifice them in order to be made right with God. What Jesus did is he came down to be the sacrifice, the final death for you and I, so that we don't have to do those actions anymore. We don't have to go sacrifice animals anymore. We have been made right by the blood of Jesus Christ for once and for all. When he said, "It is finished," on that cross, it's finished, it's done. He says, "Paid in full." You don't have to work for it anymore, because you know why? If we work for it, what's our payment? Death still. He came to fulfill the law, fulfill everything, so that we don't have to experience, get this, a second death. What's the second death? Our spirit. Total separation from him. You have a choice right now of who you want to run to, the decisions that you make right now. And I told you, for some of you in here, and this was me, I have all the time. And I told you, just like that 10, 9, that's coming for you and I. We can't escape it. Doesn't matter how much sunscreen I put on. Doesn't mean how many times I stay in my house because I'm worried about things. I cannot escape it. You know what, though? When I give my faith, my heart to God, at least I can face it because it's a reality, and I can actually look to it for joy in my life because I know this isn't the end. I'm just passing through. And every moment I have here, I want to give back to God. Why? Because he put his breath into my lungs. With every breath I have, I want to worship him because I know my time's short, our time is short, and I don't want to waste my life on things that are earthly. I want to see earthly things and present the gospel to them. I'm going to stand before God someday. You're going to stand before God someday, and you and I are going to give an account of the time that he gave with us. This is the judgment seat of Christ. We're not being judged by our sins anymore. For those of you who have put your faith in Christ, you do not have to fear standing before Christ. Why? He paid for that. You're going to be judged on what you did with his name. And what is it that you've done with his name right now? Jesus got to taste death for us so that we don't have to experience that anymore in the long run. We're just going to be sleeping. And one day you're going to hear his voice saying, hey, come on. Can you imagine when we close our eyes here and our hands go like this, that we're just going to see Christ? To be absent from the body is present with the Lord. We're going to get into heaven and hell in these upcoming messages, and we are going to experience true freedom, true joy for all eternity. It's all because Christ came down and died for our sins. God does not send people to hell. That was our consequence, our flag for our choices, but he sent his son to come rescue us from that hurricane. That is the boat that has been coming for us every single day. The last book that I want to get to is to the left. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And this should encourage you. Verses 20 through 26. What I love is that our God lives. If you're questioning what religion to look at, you're questioning what God to follow, I think that I would want to go to the one that's alive. If I'm going on a journey and there's a fork in the road and there's a dead guy and a guy that's alive and I need help, which one am I going to ask questions to? So why not put your faith, your trust, your obedience in a God who lives, not one who's still down there rotting? Let's wake up. We have a God who rose and conquered death, hell, the grave for you and for me, and that's who I want to turn to every day of my life. When I'm lost, when I'm hopeless, when I'm helpless, and the world's spinning, there's one who's in control of the world and uses it as a footstool. His name is Jesus. He says this in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20, but as it is, Christ has been what? Raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Hear me there. The first fruits, that's important. That is a promise. When it's in God's word, it is so. That's the first one to be raised from the dead. That means there's more to come. That means you and I, when we put our faith in Christ, we put our trust in Christ, when we give him all of our hearts, he's the first to be raised. And that means others are going to follow soon. 21, for since death came through one man, that's through Adam, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. For just as in Adam all die, so also in Christ, what? All will be made alive. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward, at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end. When he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, when he abolishes all rule and all authority and power. For he must redesign until he puts all his enemies under his feet. Ready for the last one? The last enemy to be abolished is what? Death. Death is our enemy because of sin. Satan wants to use it. He wants to bring death to this world. The blood of Christ is what brings life, but Satan's after blood. And death is an enemy. And well, guess what Christ is going to do someday? He is going to destroy the final enemy, death. That's an amen and a hallelujah. Verse 55. Go with me just right to the right to verse 55 of the same chapter. This is what we will get to say for all eternity because what Christ did on a cross with his hands outstretched for you and for me when he says it is finished. You know what he gets to say? Death, where is your victory? Death, where is your sting? It has nothing on us anymore because Christ came and he conquered. And when we just say yes to Jesus, we confess our sins to him. He's faithful and just to forgive us of those sins. And we say, you are my Lord and my Savior. We get to experience life for all eternity, praising the one for all time who came and conquered death, sin, and the grave for us. I don't know about you, but at that time when I'm in heaven, I'm not going to be worshiping like this. I'm not be concerned about the lights. I'm not going to be concerned about who's in front of me. I'm going to look to the God who's always been there. I'm just going to praise him. I'm going to make a joyful noise, no matter how bad my voice is. because of what he came to do, and only him could do that. Why? Because he lived a perfect life here, a sinless life here, and he sucked all the sins on the cross for you and for me so we can experience life for all eternity. There's no more death because of Jesus Christ. He conquered it, and we are promised that if we put our faith in him, we confess our sins to him, we turn out of our lifestyle and put our faith in Jesus Christ, we can experience that for all time. I think it's good to be reminded of that, because it could be easy to forget the gospel. Forget what we were saved from. And God doesn't just want to save us from something. He wants to save us for something. To go and make disciples. To go and tell others about the good news. And I want to close with this. When Bailey was singing that song, "Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus from the streets." With this hurricane, there's this little boy named Micah. 7 years old. Got swept away. And his mom heard her little boy crying, saying, "Jesus, I hear your voice. Jesus, I need your presence. Jesus, I'm coming." 7 years old. That boy has more faith than most of us today. His testimony should live on. And keep going, because in his darkest moments of being carried underwater, he calls out to Jesus because he knows that he's there, he knows that he's real, and he knows that he loves him. 7-year-old faith. That's the faith we need, is childlike faith in our darkest moments to call on the name of Jesus and he will rescue you. That mom gave an interview and she did it with joy. And she said, "I know whose hands my baby boy's in right now." Just like I said at the beginning, whose hands are you in when you're going to take your last breath, when all the world is caving in on you? That little boy got to call out to Jesus. And you know what he's doing right now? He's still praising him. We need to be that testimony right now, to know that we have a God who lives so that others may live when we call on his name. And so if you can, I just want to pray and bow your heads and close your eyes. And today's the day of salvation. Today's the day to come back to him. Today's the day to lay our burdens at his feet. If you've been holding on to them, know that he's conquered them. And it's time just to surrender. And if you want to call on the name of Jesus this morning, if you say, "Jesus, I need you. I'm being swept away by these things, but I know that you're there. I understand that I have broken your law. I understand that I have sinned, and I understand that there's separation from you, but I know that the answer is you, because you've walked in my shoes and you've overcame it all." If that is you this morning, you're like, "Matt, I'm sick of this. I'm ready to take a stand. I can't do this anymore. I want to be bold and say, yes, I need Jesus." If that's you this morning, can you just raise your hand? I want to pray over you. I want to pray for you. I want to say, "Hey, I see you, and I want to make sure that you say yes to Jesus before we leave here this morning." If that's you, can you raise your hand? Awesome. I see you. Yes, I see you. Praise God. Praise God. You can put your hands down, and if I want to pray over you as well. If you have said, "Hey, Matt, I've drifted a little bit. It's time for me to come back to him. I'm ready. Today is the day." If that's you, can you also raise your hand so I can pray over you? I want to pray over you. Yep, I see you too. Yes, I see you. Praise God. Yes, I see you over here. Yeah. Amen. Praise God to that. During this worship song, I'm going to be praying right here on my knees. If anyone wants prayer, if you want to pray, you can go ahead and right now just come forward and just pray right here. We're going to pray to God, the one who came, who died, he rose again. If you want to come out of your seats and join me up here, I'm going to be praying over here and just praying for God, for one, that he saved us from death, that he saved us from hell, he saved us from the grave, and because he lives. And I want to pray over those that rose their hands and just praise God that he sent his son Jesus to rescue us. And so during this time of worship, if you want to come up and join me after this, we're going to praise God. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for all that you have done. Thank you for sending your son Jesus Christ to come and die for us in our place, to make a way back to you, to make a way to see you, to make a way to rejoice, to fix that relationship that was broken off of our decisions. For those, Lord, right now that are here and we've done things, Lord, we have sin in our lives, I just ask that we take this time to reflect on our choices and our sins, and we lay them to your feet and know that you will forgive us. May we know that you are a God who forgives and that there's hope in. If there's anyone here, Lord, that has never said yes to you, I ask that they just confess that in their heart.
I know there's no prayer that saves us, but it's by the blood of Jesus Christ. I just ask that they call upon his name today. For those that said, yes, today is the first day that I'm going to raise my hand, I thank you, Lord, that we got to see souls saved and we get to praise with them for all eternity to you. For those that have said it's time to come back, thank you, Lord, for stirring in them the desire to come back to you. Help us to know how to walk alongside people, to see the people that we're sitting by or that we bump into, to say, hey, how can I be praying for you? Thank you, Lord, that there is hope in our lives, and it's not just death, and the grave is our last source of hope, Lord, but we can look forward to eternity out of that grave because of what you have done through Jesus Christ. We love you, Lord. We praise you. We thank you for those that rose their hand and for those that said in their heart, for those across at other churches right now that are giving their lives to you. Thank you, Lord. What an amazing thing. May this be a sweet sound to your ear, Lord. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.